Okay, fire away.
Terry, what was your initial, I mean, you guys happy, obviously, to get this kind of process over with, to move forward to the next step?
Yeah, well, it's been, you know, it's been going on since August. And once we got the invitation and acceptance by the board of directors of the Big 12, we started negotiating with the American Athletic Conference, and they had to pause a little bit because they were trying to get, they were also doing their own due diligence and also recruiting new members in as well. So it took a little time. So we really started to get back onto the negotiations. Maybe November, paused a little bit in December, started back in January, and you know, just couldn't really come to a conclusion. So a lot of, when I say collegial grandstanding, people holding their grounds. It was good that we ended on what we feel really good about it. The main thing for the ADs, I'm not speaking on behalf of those, but I can say it's just, trying to give your fan base, your student athletes, your coaches, your key stakeholders, your alumni, everybody that's involved in your program, really some definitive timetables now when you're entering. So I think we did that.
How well does this timetable work with what UCF wants to achieve?
That's what we wanted. I think when we looked at the other schools, at least I did a little research when those schools left, Rutgers, Louisville, UConn left two years earlier. We were going to be leaving one season earlier. I think it works out really good. I don't think the Big 12 was ready for us this year anyway. Even if we wanted to go in, that wouldn't have been probably doable for them, just because of the conference schedules. It's really all about scheduling. It's very complex to do that. And for us, we've been on an 8-game conference schedule for football, and you have 4 non-conference games, and you have to start canceling games. Those are, you have buyout clauses and all that kind of stuff. So now, what going forward will be? Schedule, we only have 3 conference games. So that changes our scheduling philosophy a lot in football. Won't really affect other sports as much. As you know, the lion's share of our revenue comes from football and game receipts. We're going to have to navigate through that.
$80 million buyout. Do you feel that's fair? I know some of it's backloaded. UConn paid significantly less and had less notice given. So how do you feel about that?
I think sometimes you trade time for money. And I think terms were very fair for both, and the 3 teams that are leading have a lot of value in this conference, and very competitive, and this is a very competitive conference. So I think it worked out just fine. We're all happy to be moving on, and I appreciate the leadership of the American Conference, Mike Oresco, the board chair, and especially our presidents, mine in particular, my boss, Alex Cartwright. Helped navigate through these. He was a great sounding board, and he was very active, and got really active at the end, and so we really appreciate it.
Terry, how much of the money, the exit fee, is coming from the Big 12, or is it all coming specifically?
We're responsible for it. Okay, you're the Athletic right. Association is, okay. Yes. So I think that's really kind of important. This is an Athletic Association debt, and the Athletic Association was the member of the Big 12, and I signed the exit yesterday, and so we'll be responsible for it. Yeah, so we just got to navigate. That's why this Mission 12 initiative that we put out is so important to the future of our program and the transition to the Big 12. So we'll continue to navigate that. That's why we have that microsite on our website that talks about how the plan of the transition. It's a major funding. Not only are we trying to, we have the funding that we have to take care of on the exit, but there's a buy-in in the Big 12, and then there's also all the operating capital that you have to raise money for, the facilities and personnel. So the whole idea is to try to put all of our coaches in the top half, and we're doing that. The plan is working, and we're doing that with some of our coaches now, and we're still far away in some of our sports.
Can you expound on that a little bit? Yes. How Mission 12 is moving along, yeah. And are you accomplishing your goals that you set out?
Thank you. It's great. So we put that out. We announced it to the public and our alumni and our Knight Nation, and people are reading it, and they're trying to help us. And so basically what Mission 12 is, it's basically we're going down three parallel tracks. We have to raise our operating capital. That's the operating budgets of the department. Personnel, salaries, and coaches, and then maintenance. Obviously, keep the lights on, the doors open, keep our structures sound, and then new projects, capital projects. And so Mission 12 is that initiative to help us with that. Right now, what we're focused on is operating capital and personnel. Trying to keep the coaches that we have, trying to get them into that top half of the Big 12 if all possible. We're doing, I think, very well with our women's sports. It's easy to do that when we have really good coaches with our women's teams. And we're trying to, some of our male sports are more further away. A lot of that has to do with the rights fees they've been getting and the broadcast rights fees and the TV distributions they've been getting over the years as opposed to ours.
Speaking of that, yeah. When you join the Big 12, do you know what your media distribution will be for the 2 years, while this TV contract is still in effect?
For the next 2 years?
For the next 2 years.
Yeah, it's 18 and 19. Well, I've talked about that in the press conference last August. Yeah. But think about it. Everybody thinks, oh, you're making all this much more money, but think about what the buyout is. Think about what the buy-in is. Think about all your expenses you have. It goes pretty fast, right? So,
when the new media deal kicks in for the Big 12 in a couple of years, what does that do for UCF?
Yeah, it could be a game changer for us. We have to do our part with the league. We have to continue to be competitive. We've got to continue to grow our emerging brand nationally. We need our fans watching our games. We need lots of eyeballs. We need attendance. And I think when you do all that, then I think that's when the broadcast companies will come back and say, we've got to have this. This is a major brand. They've got a lot of eyeballs. This can create a lot of value for our property.
Terry, 25, will we get a full media share from the 12?
Yes. Yes, after the 2 years, there won't be full share numbers. Yeah. I'm not going to speak before, but the current Big 12 members, which we appreciate, reduce some of their fees to get our four teams in. So I don't take that lightly, and that there's a lot of gratitude on our part that they were allowed to do that. They believed it. I was on a call today with the current Big 12, and they're over the moon. Everybody's really excited about it. I've been to a couple of Big 12 meetings in the last few months, and just talking to the ADs one-on-one, the commissioner, the conference office, presidents, they're all really excited about our, not only all four teams, but the fact that we're bringing in the Florida market. And so this is a very exciting day that we can be definitive when we're going to the Big 12.
Terry, I know you and I talked a little bit about scheduling, future scheduling for football, for instance. You were kind of on a pause because of all of this going on.
Yeah.
How much now does it help you ramp up when you get some teams?
Well, you still got to get teams to play. So, I mean, a lot of the teams are already scheduled out through 2030. And so I'm trying to actually move some games, and I'm not getting a lot of success with some of the teams. Our philosophy is going to change. When we were in the American, we were maybe trying to play a couple of Autonomy 5 schools or Power 5 schools in the non-conference to help us with the CFP rankings. But now, when you're in this league and you're going to be battling every week, you probably don't want to play that. The rule is in the Big 12, you have to at least play one. And in 23, we don't have one right now, so we may have to get grandfathered in. We have Boise on the road. They may use that as the one, because that's a tough road game for us. So we're not going to add a game. We'll have three non-conference games then, and we'll wait for the nine-game schedule. And we'll do a rotation 4 and 5 probably the first year in the Big 12 we'll have four Big 12 home games and five on the road. Just to learn it.
You've been part of those discussions, yeah. I know, with the Big 12 lately. Has there been talk about going with divisions, those kind of things?
Yeah, well, yeah. And they've been great about asking our opinion. And, you know, I haven't served on the college football playoff selection committee. I'm all about whatever can make put our two best teams in the conference championship, so we can have a chance to play in the Final Four, the playoffs. I think at that particular time, right, based on that, I think right now probably no divisions would be my preference. Not to say I couldn't be swayed one way or the other way, but that would probably just be my preference. But I'm not speaking on behalf of the Big 12. And I think it gives you some flexibility. But, you know, I think the rotation of the games that you don't play, and this also is predicated on Texas and Oklahoma's when they're actually exiting as well.
In Texas and Oklahoma, if they're in the league for the 2 years, 23-24, what are the chances, you think, when those two teams would potentially play in UCF, or do you think the legacy baseball school would keep those games?
As much of a chance of playing Kansas, you know, or Kansas State or Iowa State. You know, so it just depends on the rotation. I'm trying to horse trade that, see what can happen. I would say that I am told, of course, how this changes, could change tomorrow, that they'll be in the league for sure.
Obviously, the eye goes to football, but how much?
They're still in the meeting, so. Sorry.
You're good. How much does this change the entire athletic department, not just football?
Changes everything. I'm going to quote my provost, Michael Johnson, Dr. Michael Johnson. He says, joining the Big 12 changes our academic profile at this university. So not only does this change athletics, who we recruit, the type of people we recruit, the revenues, the opportunities for more sponsorships, multimedia rights, this also changes the reflection of the academic profile of this university. And that's not my words, that's the academic professionals on our campus, so that's good to hear. And I had that conversation with our president, Alex Cartwright, a lot yesterday. He goes, yeah, that's what he says. That's exactly, and he agrees. And actually, our dean, Jarley, has said it. I've done a couple of speaking engagements for his board, and he said this is a game changer for us academically. So this is great. I mean, you saw that. You know, even the magazines, the Streets of Smith magazine, are putting us on the cover with Miami, Florida State, Florida, and so I think we've earned it, and I think you're going to continue to see us be a strong program.
When will you know the inaugural Big 12 football schedule? Is that something that the league hopes to release by late summer, fall, or?
Well, I think first thing they're going to do is they're going to try to do a campus visit. I don't know if they're going to open up to the media. We'll surely let you know. But like donors and key constituents, civic leaders, all that stuff, because they're definitely going to do a campus tour. They've already done BYU, of course, because they're not in the league for football. They are in their other sports. I think that this, probably this summer, this fall, you'll probably start seeing a little bit either, maybe not exactly the schedule, but at least the format, whether divisions or no divisions. They've talked about, since we've got a really good geography now, and we've covered like three time zones, which is really good from a broadcast standpoint, is, not trying to travel, a far distance two games in a row. We've gotten to those conversations, like West Virginia doesn't go to BYU and Texas Tech back to back. Those type of formatting we're talking about. So it's been good.
Terry, you obviously, schools like West Virginia, TCU, for instance, went through this experience making the jump into the Power Five conference. Have you spoken with some of those people?
I was actually in the league when they made the jump. So this is my sixth conference realignment since I've been involved in the conference. College athletics. I saw what TCU did when they came to the league, and when some of the teams left the league. Um, so I mean, I think you just it's really a funding model, facilities, operating capital, and personnel is really what you're trying to hold on to. The difference is it wasn't NIL, and transfer portals. That has changed and made a little bit more complex as far as recruiting and you know, I think you'll start seeing the days of these palatial locker rooms and all these facilities will change a little bit because of NIL. And it'll be more like a maybe like the NFL or nice facilities, but more about what kind of benefits you get outside of the athletic department with NIL. So we're all navigating this, so we're trying to figure out.
Do you have a sense of how much more the travel budget will be? I assume you have to.
Well, think about it. It's not going to be that much. So we're already going to Tulsa. You know, you're already going to Tulsa. You're already going, you know, Iowa State, Kansas, and you're going to Texas. You're going to go on the road five times. Usually, you might do that already. You know, I'm still focusing on playing as many games in Florida as possible this coming fall. We're only leaving the state three times. That's fantastic. And then hopefully in the future, 24, we'll have at least 24. We'll have at least six home games in six games in the state of Florida, hopefully. So we're trying to minimize that as much. I don't think it's,
basketball is like chartering to some of these.
That's the operating capital. The Big 12 charter. Volleyball teams charter. Sometimes softball teams charter. And so and when you're going to some of the towns, and I've of course been to all, most of these towns, Stillwater, where they're, you can fly in close to you, but if you can get in charter and get right out after the games, you get home from class, back in two hours, maybe home in your bed by 12:30, and you're up going to class the next day. So we don't talk about academics that much since it's NIL. So the academics is still a major focus here. So I'm just telling you guys that.
How excited are you personally about this? You took the job, you're excited about the opportunity anyway, but to look at all the changes since you arrived, going to the Big 12, a place you're very familiar with, how exciting is that for you?
It's really exciting because I grew up in Kansas City, and used to go to the Big 8 basketball tournaments, used to go to a lot of the games in that area. Was coached in the Big 8, when we transitioned from Big 8 to Big 12 the first time, when we merged with the Southwest Conference, and then I was there the second time, and same thing, had a conference realignment then, and so the fact that I get to go back to my roots, and I followed my whole childhood, and why I became a huge college sports fan. I went to camps, University of Kansas, basketball camps. Larry Brown was the coach, and so it's really cool. And then the thing that I'm probably most excited about, they actually asked me this question in the meetings last week, was, do you guys think Jason Siegel's going to kill me when I still hear me say this? What do you think about hosting the basketball tournament? I said, it would be hard for me to vote to move out of Kansas City, because Kansas City men's basketball tournament is about as good of a tournament I've ever been around. So exciting to take our fans, our awesome fans, to Kansas City and to blow out that whole city, man. I can't wait to do that and to compete with our men's and women's teams. It is a fantastic tournament. So you can see I start smiling because it's so fun. The basketball tournament. There's not another basketball. I don't think it's ACC. I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it. Big East. I don't want to hear it. It is the Big 12 basketball tournament is the best. And you have all the concentrated fan bases right in that area. It is. I cannot wait for our fans to go up there.
Having a definitive timeline, how does that affect the building projects, the football complex, everything that you want to do that's already on the calendar?
It's just more funding. You just got to fund it. You got to find ways to fund it. And, as you guys know, that Florida is very, our state is very restrictive. Unlike the other two public schools that are coming in the league, they have a little bit more, from what I'm told, a little more fungibility with their dollars, state allocated dollars. So we just got to navigate through it. So that's why that Mission 12, I'll go back to Mission 12. That's why we put that out there each year to really illustrate our plan, what it means. We're pretty specific on it, what we got to do, where we got to be in development, corporate dollars, where we got to be for capital dollars. I mean, and we're working the plan, and we're hitting our marks. We just, it just takes a while.
Terry, this is a chance to pump up the teams a little bit, but you know, a year out of joining the Power Five, competition-wise, where is UCF? How well do you think,
preparing and joining? I'm really excited. I mean, even though obviously basketball is the number one basketball league. It's basketball league, number one in the country. It is a powerhouse. I mean, you literally have teams that have losing records in the Big 12 getting the NCAA tournament, or maybe close to losing records. Don't quote me on the losing, but very either 500. And they're on the fence at least, I know that. The fact that we beat two teams this year, men's basketball, and then we're in the Sweet 16, I know we can do it. I think all of our sports can transition. This is still a very competitive conference that we're in, and we're going to have a target on our back this whole time next year. And so we have to be focused as a team and coaching staff, as an administration, be very focused about the last year of our conference, so in preparedness for the first year of the Big 12, because they're well-funded programs, and there's a lot of it. Sports are very big in the Big 12, and they are very, very competitive. As you guys saw, we have a really good softball team. We went up there to Oklahoma, and they're pretty good too. They just won the national championship, pretty good, huh? So I think the one thing I'll tell you, we have the right coaches here. I hope I never have to hire another coach as long as I'm here. And I really believe in them, and I believe that we can compete for conference championships in the Big 12. Compete for conference championships in the Big 12, you can win national championships.
You kind of alluded to it earlier. UCF's been a little bit of a little brother, treated that way in Florida. Oh. How much does this change that?
I think it's not just Florida. I think you get those. I think it's like the little puppy you see on the street, and it's like, really act like they pat you on the head. Like, oh, you're cute. You're so cute. I know you're cute. But you're not them. It's one of those type of things. We're gonna be them. I'm excited about that. The goal is, I've got you on my shoulder. I get in these meetings and you're around other ADs, and just because they're 18 to 22 year olds might be a little better than your 18 to 12 doesn't mean that they're better. We're going to show people who we are, and we're just getting started. This emerging brand we have here will be a national brand, and we just got to get people in the Big 12 to start calling us UCF, not Central Florida. So I think, every time, I like to yield to the gentleman from Central Florida. No, I'm just kidding. But UCF, and we'll get that. They'll be calling us UCF for everybody across the country. And I've always had a chip on my shoulder. We've always taken the road less traveled. My career, and so this is no different. And you know what? We're going to make a huge splash, literally and figuratively. And I really believe, but we can't do it alone. It takes a community. It takes the campus, it takes donors, it takes civic leaders, it takes our student athletes, it takes our coaches, it takes everybody to buy into this. And if you're not, then I'm talking about people to pick up your trash. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that everybody has to pick it. One of the greatest illustrations of that, the guy that cooks food for us over there at the Garvey Center, our chef, he's bought in. Not even from here, he put UCF on his license plate, and he buys it. He cares. Every time he prepares a meal for our student athletes, he cares about the fueling. And that's just one example. And that's the type of people we need, because we got a long ways to go. This is just the beginning, folks. This is not the end. This is what we worked hard for. It's what all of our people that were at Florida Technical University dreamed of. But this is the beginning. This is the beginning of a new era of UCF, not only academically but also athletically.
Terry, you talked about when you first got here, you guys were talking about national championships, playing in the college football playoff, getting in the college football playoff. Now you guys next year, obviously, it's a much better pathway to get to the playoff. Yeah. How much is that? I mean, it feels like, you know, from where UCF was maybe in 2017 to being, you know, on the outside looking in to maybe possibly getting into a championship. I mean, how does that show kind of the progression that this program has gone?
That's the goal. I mean, you compete. You know, you compete for national championships. You compete for conference and national championships. And I really believe we can do it. I think we have some work to do. I think we have to raise our operating capitals. I think we have some facility. We have the Twin Cities facility stuff. And that's the goal, is to win national championships. And we're in the competition business. I mean, we're educators and around about. The way, because the focus is academics. We don't talk enough as practitioners. We don't talk enough about the academic side of college athletics. I mean, I know we put it out on graphics and we tweet out stuff, but that is what we do. That's our core principles. And we're constantly challenging our own core principles so they remain relevant. That is, get an education, get a degree, and then get a job. But we are in the competition business, and that's what most people see. So our whole existence is preparing young people classroom and life after college. Most of our student athletes do not go to college. I mean, do not go to the pros. Most of our student athletes do not go to the pros. And so we have to prepare for that. But why they're here, we want them to have an unbelievable opportunity to be highly successful in the playing surfaces. And I think we can do that. When you hear ADs or people say you can't be good at both, that's bulk. That's not. We're gonna be able to do that. But it takes resources. And so first and foremost, academics, life after college, jobs, and then competition. If you take care of that and your discipline and your pursuits on a daily basis, you can be a highly productive program. There's no question in my mind we can be a top 25 program in the Learfield Cups and all those, the Director's Cups, in every one of our sports. There's no question in my mind. We just have to have the right people.
Mr. Mohajir, you talk about how this is the beginning of a new era. I mean, you got the naming rights deal taken care of, the Big 12 timeline has been ironed out. So what else could be in store for this new era?
Got some more good news. Do you want me to give it to you now?
Yeah.
If you want, please.
No. He's like, no. He said, no, don't. He said, no. He's one of our students. We still got a lot of work to do. I mean, we're not done. We had news, good news today. Naming rights, FBC mortgage, it's huge for our program. We've got some other things in the work, in the hopper on sponsorships and gifts, and we'll hopefully be announcing those fairly soon. We're still working on that. We just sent out our ad to advertise for design for football campus, to advertise for our architect. We're putting together, it takes a long time. State of Florida, it takes about 6 weeks to put those advertisements out, then you get to score things, and then you narrow them down, then you hire. So it's not a real fast process, but I think once we get to that process, we'll be able to move pretty quickly. What you see in football campus may not, what we introduced last summer, may not be exactly the way it is going to be going forward because of change of philosophy and maybe priorities. But one of the things that's most glaring is just the upper bowl of the south end zone. When we did the football campus concept, I never saw a game here. I've been in the stadium before, I've done a lot of research prior to this, but like the South Florida game kind of changed my mind when we were in that end zone, and putting in loge boxes the way the campus was proposed. Football campus probably won't do that now. We'll look at some other type of premium areas because I don't want to lose the denseness of the fan base up there, because there's no question in my mind our fans help will us to win that game because of that end zone. And so I don't want to lose that. So we have to be really cautious about not losing this great atmosphere. And that was one of the things I was telling a bunch of the ADs this past week. It was like, you're going to love coming to watch our games. It's just so fun.
Also,
yeah. Anybody?
That's good.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. All right. Awesome. Thanks. Yeah. Awesome.